one more question from 205. They're feeling very left out.
Good morning. First off, thanks to you. Everybody talking about student pressures, and the student feels like my parents will be in pressure. I'm asking about, we have only two children and we are feeling pressure. But you have around like 3,000 students, and how you can handle pressure of these 3,000 children which you go and like, and you tease them and to keep like, to be get good and goal. My first question is that. The second question is, everybody is taking its goal to achieve the Google job, Facebook job, like only that. But I think now time to give up back to society. What you will do for your country and what you will do for society. I don't think like we are having problems of water, like other problems. Is there any faculty or like any course and like any teach regarding to motivate students to do something for country and something for the society, not to achieve the goal only like to get job from the for Google and Facebook? And I mean to say, the problem what we are feeling like water, like others, then, and you have the good brain and you have capability to create a excellent brain. So this is my suggestion to all of you and helps you to take the things. This is just a suggestion, sir.
Thank you. That's a very good suggestion. We do have several faculty members working on and applying their technology or their scientific skills to problems that are of great importance to the society at large, and many in Indian context, many more in Indian context. So that's true. What you said is absolutely true. We also would like to tell the students that looking at jobs in Google or Facebook and you know, solving whatever the problems of Google and Facebook's, it may not be as satisfying as solving problems in your immediate neighborhood, in your own country or other countries like this. So we do have several research projects which are specifically aimed at those things, and we do tell our students that they should consider that, and you should also tell, parents also should tell them that, you know, these things are very good. It's not only about the brand name of the company or the brand name of the university or something that you go to. It's about what you can achieve, and we do have several students who do that, but we can have many more. So thank you for that suggestion. And regarding comments of our stress on us, so that's our job. We have been doing it, for some of us, for 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, and it's we don't think of it as stress. We think of it as pleasure, because where do we know which career or which line of work in the world get every year 200 to 500, I mean, today the PG admissions are going on, 500 young minds come and they go and become something or other in the world. And we go wherever, you know, one of my colleagues said they were in some airport somewhere and suddenly somebody came and said, oh, I was this batch and so on. So wherever, whichever airport you go in the world, so you may find, run into somebody whom you may not remember, but they'll come and greet you. So no other profession in the world can get that that level of satisfaction. And we have been engaging with our alumni. Our alumni have been engaging with us quite a bit. We had three alumni meets or four alumni meets last year, in, because we are completing 20 years. One in Bangalore, one in San Francisco, one in Seattle, and the last one here in Hyderabad. And the connect that we have with them, especially since we are being a younger institution and first batch left, graduated in 2002, and many of us were actually there at that, so we personally have good connection with them. That pleasure is cannot be described in words. So we have feel no stress, we feel extreme pleasure. One more question from 205. I promise three.
Good morning, this is Srinath. Just a quick question for Professor Rajiv Sengal. I think his articulation of you know, what IIIT stands for is awesome. But can you hear me? Are you audible?
We can hear you, yes.
Okay, great. So his articulation was great, right? I really in awe in terms of what he stated about setting up lofty goals, right? not the treetops, but the Everest, right? So just to follow up on the question that was asked earlier about goal setting, I think if you have some kind of goal setting for the kids early on, how to set SMART goals, write them down, achieve them. If you can coach the students for setting those goals, I think that will be great. If you have something in that order, that'll be awesome as well. The second one, follow-up question is metrics drive behaviors, always, everywhere. So I see that in the first 2 years, your grading system, whatever you have, is the right kind. It's the right transition from the 10th, 12th grade to engineering studies. I think that's the perfect way to do it. But for the full rounded development, I think you have to set up additional metrics, because those metrics would drive the right behaviors that you want in the kids. So I'd like to hear from Professor Rajiv what he has, his thoughts on those two items.
First question was about, can there be coaching? Yeah, can there be some sort of... So there are always two aspects. One, the first aspect is opening up the vision, and that coaching will not help. That one has to just have different methods by which people think beyond small boundaries. People think big. So that part, of course, we try to do through value education. And some of the people then take it, but also understand it's a very difficult task, because rest of the environment is just not for it, right? Including most of the parents. So they say, yeah, being great is fine, but you don't worry about it, you get this job now. So unfortunately, the goals get lowered in the process of this education itself. And children don't realize it, nor do the parents. So yes, so there's, what are the ways by which one can open up vision? So that is partly through process of self-discovery. So, you know, motivators which are not extrinsic, which are intrinsic. For example, this attendance, extrinsic motivator, give them A grade, 100%. This is an extrinsic motivator. Unfortunately, it doesn't help in the long run. In fact, it harms. So what is needed is an intrinsic motivator. Intrinsic motivator comes when you understand yourself. And you then actively, that is where coaching comes. Where you, after having understood a larger goal, now you say, what I can do? What is my role? So that is where the institution can provide more help, in terms of curricula, in terms of active guidance in research, etc. So, and also set up things like, which our director is very keen, social service, motivate students to do service in society. And, you know, that serves to ignite our internal motivators. So what then helps us, we are not doing social service to help others. That is first thing we should realize. Social service is to help ourselves, because we open up, we set up larger goal for ourselves, and we become happier and more successful. So that is the view. But unfortunately, these aspects are not yet understood properly in our own society. So this is where it is proving to be a difficult task. But what we hope, the seed we are planting will flower 10 years from now. Okay, and it will flower earlier if you also join in and help in that process. The second part was about matrix, setting up matrices for this. So here, you know, the real matrix is internal. That internal motivation, ignition has taken place or not, right? Agni has fired inside. Nobody can stop it after that. No, that's what we want. But in that ignition, what are some of the matrices? So that is where I would not call it matrices, but pathways. We provide some pathways. So somebody who wants to do social service, elements are provided. Somebody who wants to apply his or her research to social problems, we provide avenue for that. So rather than matrices, I would like to provide avenues for doing all this. And those students who get motivated and want to pursue and take up those avenues, after that they will realize through that internal firing, and then they are ready for blast off and nobody can stop them. Thank you.
Elaborating a little bit on the last part, we have created a system where we don't think of this as a 4-year course or 5-year course or something. There are academic requirements, but we want the students to be to explore whatever is the is their interest or their passion. So if somebody wants to take off 1 year or a semester to go somewhere, and we have had several examples of students doing that, not too many but a few examples, they want to go and spend time. So we had two students a year ago, they went to some school in Assam and they're just studying in some very tribal or rural school in Assam. They spent the whole semester there trying to to understand what they were doing and write some report about it and so on. Similarly, we have had people who went and spent a year in the Dalai Lama ashram a few years ago and came as a transformed person. So these need not be towards, I'm not saying go and spend time in some IBM and working some, that's a very ordinary goal. Okay, as Professor Sangal said, it's a very ordinary goal. You can do that, but that's not the kind that'll enhance you, that'll make you a different person. So don't think of, from your side or from the student side, don't think of them as a 4-year degree program or a 5-year program. This is 2019, 2013, May, I will be out and I will be planning for this and that and that and that. This is how most of society treats it. We would like our students to say, I want to acquire, there are requirements for the degree. There's no doubt there's a credit requirement. You can earn it in many, many flexible ways. But in between, if you want to be away for a year or a 6 semester, do something else, enjoy or experience something else, gain insight, come back, continue from where you left or continue. Because after the first 2 years, things are so flexible. There's nothing like you will missing out things if you are away for a semester. You will come, continue with some other courses and so on. And we have also had ways to give credits to some of these things that they do elsewhere, provided it can be mapped to something that's required, etc. So this is a journey that they are, a journey of technology exploration as well as self-exploration that the kids are undertaking along with all of us, and we want to be supportive in different ways. So even including such things are possible. Okay, now one question from here.
Hi.
05, okay.
Yeah, hi. My name is Nitin. I have 2 questions. I seen the T-Hub over here. So what is the T-Hub and IIIT Hyderabad, what's the role and what's the opportunity for kids to work over there? So it's, I believe it's a startup concept. So how the research and startup go together? So if you can elaborate on that. And second question is, you have almost 1500 plus resources. So is there anything we know that so far in India, there is no single operating system coming up. Now you have top class people of 1500 plus student here. So anything, something you as a institute are trying to come up. So in tomorrow's the Android or Microsoft goes away from, for some reason with India, your institute or, the work will still go on.
Second one is a very excellent comment. First one about T-Hub, the T-Hub is here and it's one of the largest startup and innovation ecosystem in the country, and we work closely with them. And I know several of our students do internship there, etc. We also have our own incubator in the other building, and ours is, we are told we are the largest or among the largest academic incubators in the country in terms of number of startups, the people involved, etc. So having said that, there's a lot of talk about startups these days, which are very good. The good thing about startups is today, startups, 5 years ago, startup means you build some Instagram or something that is, very social, very glamorous item. And that, I think, has gone away. Today, startups are actually trying how to do things that are relevant for India or for the local society, by and large, much more than what it used to be. So that way, it's very good and connects to your second part of the question. So startups are there. There are lots of opportunities. Several of our students start up things. They take a semester break to work on their own startups. All these things happen. And at this point, we would rather caution against overdoing such things. I mean, there are, we see people who are working on one startup, two startups simultaneously and trying to do five courses and so on. It's good. I mean, there's a good element in it. They're overstretching themselves. They're getting out of their comfort zone. But then, you know, there is time to do some of these things later. There's no need to do all that in second year or third year of your undergraduate education. But if there are opportunities to do internships and what, do you know, experience startup world here, and our own startups, I mean, the incubator also has lots of startup, good program, good support, etc. So, I mean, don't get into it because it's glamorous. Get into it if you're really passionate for it. And similarly, what you said later, yes, it's true that there are, you know, the resources here should be used in a grand project like what you said, build your own Android or substitute to Android, because tomorrow, you know, we are all slaves of Google, because we walk around with Android phones. They know where you are every minute, every second, and they monetize it in different ways, and they can control you in some way. So how do we find the alternate? You know, this is not only a problem for, say, military secrets or police or IAS. The Indian government does have these so-called secure phones they give to IAS officers and some of certain level, etc. But it's good for you and I also. It's not only for, you know, so-called top secret people. So these are kind of efforts. Unfortunately, we don't have any such large effort going on here. We have some small efforts in other areas like the Indian language translation or speech-to-speech translation. A major project is about to start. You speak in, I speak in Hindi and you will hear it in Telugu or, you know, whatever, on the phone. Ideally, the dream application is, of course, on my phone I speak my mother tongue and you hear it live translated in your mother tongue. There are examples, there are, you know, in Microsoft or Google and all have systems which do it in a very limited capacity, limited languages and so on. So some such effort is starting, which is coordinated by us. Yes, these are the kind of things that we would like our students and our faculty to do. Yes. Yes, question here.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing the vision and the goals of the organization, which was very eye-opening and inspiring as well. But I have a question that is much more tactical. In your experience of having so many batches in the last 20 years, and of having selected, as Professor Jayanti was saying, that you select the toppers from the various streams like JEE mains, etc. These are all top performing students. How has the performance of the students been in general in the organization? Are they skewed to the right or skewed to the left? And based on that, when you are doing the grading, do you force fit a normal curve on that, or do you allow a longer tail? How exactly is the performance of the students assessed and graded? Because that adds to a lot of stress. And these are all toppers as well, right? So how do you handle that?
I'll ask Jayanti to answer this question.
So regarding grading, see, the reason all of us are faculty is, number one, freedom. We want a lot of freedom. And one freedom we all cherish is how we grade. So no single policy, I mean, formula fits all courses. So each faculty, within some reasonable bounds, the faculty can say absolute grading, so you have to get above this cutoff, then only I'll give A. That is one style. The other is what we call as relative grading, which is based on some kind of looking at how the class performed, you fit some curve, and it need not be a bell curve, all these things. So it really differs. Now, if you ask, you know, in the graduating class, how is the performance overall, when I look at the CGPAs, I'm still waiting for our students to meet the perfect 10.0. In 20 years, nobody has got a 10.0. So that says something about the institute, yes. Over the years, no, I don't think so. Generally, there is a bit of, I mean, it depends on the motivation of the student, and different modes have different patterns, different modes of admissions. So I don't see really any skew this way or that way, no. Individual, no, even at the end of first semester we have seen, at the end of first semester, last batch, there were 6 or 7 or, you know, about 10 of them were getting. But if you ask now how they are at the end of second semester, that number drops and then progressively it drops. It drops for two reasons. One, I think for good reason, like Professor Sangal says, they're also not so particular that they should get that perfect. And second is, colleagues are tough. Yeah.
So we had a student many years ago who got some 8.5 or something in the first semester and 10 every other semester. So I talked to him, what happened? He said, first semester, he came here, he thought he should have been in IIT, and he was thinking whether I should take JEE again. He was in two minds. He didn't take the semester very seriously. He got 8 point something, not very bad grade or something. But then end of the semester, he decided this place is very good, I will be here, and then there was no looking back. I mean, so again, there has not been a 10-pointer, but like Jayanti said, and Professor Sangal said, getting those grades or perfect grades may not be and need not be the goal of individuals. It should be much higher than that. Okay, question from 205.